Hello, my name is Max Leong, and I'm going to present to you our work titled Cost Minimizing Local Anisotropic Quad Mesh Refinement. As the title suggests, we are interested in the refinement of quad meshes. Quad meshes are very useful as the edges can naturally be aligned to the principal curvatures of the underlying surface, and they have the flexibility to create strongly anisotropic cells without causing excessively small inner angles. Therefore, they are the preferred mesh data structure in many applications such as finite element methods and also in animation. While there exist methods that refine a quad mesh by creating a completely new model from scratch or by removing and remeshing a part of the model, we are interested in keeping all the original vertices of the mesh. Such a refinement is useful if you want to keep the general structure of the input mesh or if you want to transfer information from the input to the refined mesh. Such refinement methods are based on templates that are used to replace single quads. A very prominent example are these three templates proposed by Schneiders. If the refinement is isotropic, here the desired split edges are marked in magenta, these templates yield good results. The 1-4 split on the right increases the mesh resolution, while the 1-3 split is used to transition between regions of differing resolution. Due to its shape, we are referring to this template as a Y configuration. Note, however, that these templates do not allow an anisotropic refinement. So if a refinement in only one direction is desired, the mesh resolution is still increased in both directions. John and colleagues use these patterns. Here, the 1-9 split on the right increases the resolution in both directions, and the 1-4 split is used for the sizing transition. In addition, the 1-3 split template allows a refinement in only one direction. John and colleagues achieve more reasonable results for anisotropic refinement. Since John et al. Split edges into three parts, this type of refinement is referred to as tree refinement, in contrast to the two refinement of Schneider's. In general, tree refinement is preferable as it allows better control over the mesh density. There is a simple method of anisotropically refining a quad mesh with tree refinement using these templates. For every edge that is split, also split the opposite edge. Of course, this additional split may lead to another quad with a single split for which the opposite edge has to be split as well. This propagates the split over the whole mesh until the boundary is reached or a closed loop of split edges is formed. To summarize, Schneiders perform local tool refinement but can only refine isotropically and insert many singularities. John and colleagues use tree refinement for local anisotropic refinement but also introduce many singularities. The naive anisotropic tool refinement does not introduce any singularities but propagates over the whole mesh. With our method, we want to perform anisotropic tool refinement that finds a compromise between locality and number of inserted singularities. We are going to use these templates, the same templates as Schneider, with the addition of an anisotropic 1-2 split. For this example, our result would look like this. Our refinement is based on solving a binary program. In the following, I'm going to first present our basic binary program formulation. After that, I will talk about our extension of this basic formulation leading to higher quality elements when our algorithm is applied iteratively. And finally, I'm going to briefly talk about another version of our binary program which performs free refinement. Okay, let's first define our task. Given a mesh M consisting of vertices V, edges E, half edges H, and faces F, and a set S of mandatory split edges, we want to find few additional split edges yielding a conforming refinement that introduces few singularities. We also want to give the user the option to find the desired trade-off between number of elements and number of inserted singularities. If singularities are not a big problem, a solution with fewer splits but more singularities should be found. If the user dislikes singularities a lot, a solution with fewer singularities but more splits should be found. So this task is what we want to transform into a binary program. First of all, we need variables for our program. We use one binary variable for each edge. If the variable is set to 1 in the solution, the corresponding edge is split, otherwise the edge is not split. We want to find a solution with few additional splits, so we simply set up our energy, which is to be minimized as the sum of all these binary variables. Of course, we have to ensure that at least those edges that that the user asks to be split are actually split. We therefore constrain the corresponding binary variables to 1. The templates that we want to use are these: from left to right, no edge, two opposite edges, two consecutive edges, and all four edges are split. So in order to apply these templates, we have to ensure that the number of split edges per face is even. In our binary program formulation, this is easily expressed with this equality constraint, which uses two binary helper variables to express that the sum of the split indicating variable is either 0, 2, or 4. Note that I'm using S0 to S3 here as local names per face. The solution of this binary program yields the refinement with the smallest number of additional split edges. So for this example from before, the optimal solution would split these edges for which our templates can be used to find this result. As discussed earlier, the small number of splits comes with the cost of adding many Y configurations, which insert singularities. We want to be able to define a trade-off allowing us to split additional edges if this requires fewer Y configurations. This means we need to be able to detect when the variable assignment leads to the insertion of a Y configuration. We do this by adding more binary indicator variables TI. A T variable set to 1 indicates the insertion of a Y configuration. We add one variable per half edge, which is 4 variables per face, allowing us to even distinguish which of the 4 possible Ys is inserted. This in turn allows us to penalize each possible Y configuration with an individual penalty. This penalty could, for example, be based on the resulting element quality or on the valence of the quad vertices. However, for simplicity, we can consider a constant penalty for now. To force these variables to 1 if a Y configuration is inserted, we have the following constraint. To see how this constraint works, let's look at all possible conforming assignments. If none, all, or two opposite edges are split, the term on the right-hand side of the constraint will always be 0. The term only becomes 1 for the Y configuration that splits the edge of the half edge as well as the next one. Note that we add 4 constraints per face with permuted S variables to also detect the other Y configurations. This completes our basic binary formulation. By adjusting the singularity penalty C, a trade-off between locality and number of added singularities can be achieved. A low singularity penalty will lead to a more local refinement, while a larger penalty leads to fewer singularities at the cost of more splits. Here's an example for different penalties on the Rocker model. The edges which should be split are marked in magenta. These are the edges for which the distance between their center and the original surface exceeds a certain threshold, which means mainly those edges need to be split which point along the direction of largest absolute curvature, calling for an anisotropic refinement. With a low penalty, the mesh remains coarser, while larger penalties lead to a denser mesh. This is especially visible in the lower right part, where the highest penalty has almost no singularities, while the others do have a few. In this example, a user requires the edges marked in magenta around the fingertips to be split. This time, we only penalize singularities in the highlighted red region. A low penalty leads to a very local refinement, while a high penalty pushes all Y configurations to the wrist, causing an isotropic refinement in the palm of the hand. With a medium penalty, in addition to the Y configurations at the wrist, the solver carefully places two Y configurations inside the highlighted region. One of them is here, and the other one at the back of the thumb, which reduces the number of additional elements drastically. Here we compare with Schneider's and Chon's algorithm. Similar to the Rocker arm before, edges are split in order to improve surface approximation. Since Schneider's algorithm can only refine isotropically, it introduces many elements and singularities. Chon and colleagues split only a minimal number of edges, but since they perform 3 refinements, they also end up with more elements than we do. In addition, many singularities are added, which could have been avoided by splitting a few more edges. On this ghost, we can see the same behavior. Schneider's and Chon produce almost twice as many faces and 5 or 4 times as many singularities as our method. This was our basic formulation. In the next part, I want to talk about stability. A refinement algorithm is stable if the minimal angle does not depend on refinement level. Our method, as I presented it so far, is not stable. Repeated refinement can split the same quad corner several times and thus cause arbitrarily small angles as shown in this example. We extend our binary program formulation to achieve a stable algorithm. The key idea for our stable formulation is requiring that if a Y configuration should be further refined, at least both long edges have to be split as well. This leaves these 16 possible split configurations. All of these can be replaced by a pattern which corresponds to a regular 1-to-4 split, which is then further refined according to the original edge splits. For example, in the top left, ignoring the split of the diagonal, the result is all four edges of the original quad being split. So instead of inserting two Y configurations into the existing Y configuration, we replace it with a simple 1-to-4 split. In the example below, after replacing the Y configuration with a 1-to-4 split, the remaining three split edges can be resolved by inserting two Y configurations into the newly created smaller squares. With the same principle, all of these configurations can be replaced, and we ensure that every quad corner is split at most once. Using the green patterns instead of the yellow ones can easily be done for our existing formulation and yield stable results. However, the computed energy will not reflect the results correctly anymore. Consider again the top left case, which contains two phases in which two consecutive edges are split. This will add a penalty to the energy as it expects two Y configurations to be inserted. Thus, we need to adapt our formulation. We start from the same binary program that we had earlier, but now the input already contains Y configurations added in a previous iteration. To rectify the wrong energy, we add additional indicator variables to our problem. For each Y configuration in the mesh, we add 16 binary variables, one for each of the 16 cases from the previous slide, and constrain them such that they are one exactly when their corresponding split configuration is chosen by the solver. For details on these constraints, I would like to refer the interested viewer to our paper. With the help of these indicators, the energy is then adjusted to compensate for the different pattern being used. Again, let's consider the first example from before and assume a constant penalty C. Creating the Y configuration in the first iteration had a cost of 2 for the two split edges plus C for the singularity that is inserted. In our original formulation, splitting the three marked edges has a cost of 3 for the split edges plus 2C for the two inserted Y configurations. Had we split all four edges of the quad in the first iteration, the regular 1-to-4 split would have created an energy of 4. Using the adjustment term D, we want to get the same energy when reaching the regular 1-to-4 split starting from the Y configuration. Thus, we set the D value to the cost of the direct pass and subtract the cost of the upper two operations. Here we see a comparison of our basic formulation and our stable one. Edges need to be split if their midpoint is far away from the original contour. In the middle image, some quad corners are split several times, creating very small angles. This is fixed by our stable formulation. For this fan disk model, we split edges orthogonal to the sharp edges marked in magenta. Again, we can see how the stable formulation does not create very small angles. In addition, we compare with a naive splitting, that is splitting all quad strips with at least one mandatory split edge. While this does not add any singularities, it greatly increases the number of elements. The same behavior can be seen on this rocker arm model, where a quad loop spirals around the mesh and requiring to split a few edges may end up refining almost the whole mesh. In this example, only a few quads in the back are not split, and naive splitting creates more than 3 times as many elements as our splitting. Lastly, I would like to present a different variation of our basic formulation, namely one that performs tree refinement. Again, we start from our basic formulation. Now, instead of these 4 templates, for tree refinement we use this set of templates. The ones on the left with an even number of sides being split correspond to the same templates as in the two refinement case, except that edges are split in 3 instead of in 2. In addition, there is now a template for the case that only one side is split and the case that 3 sides are split. Since with these templates it is not necessary anymore that the number of split sides is even, we can simply drop the corresponding constraint and also don't need the helper variables A and B anymore. This is actually all we have to change in order to perform tree refinement. However, it is interesting to take a look at how the singularity indicator constraints behave. As before, the term on the right-hand side of the inequality is 1 only if 2 consecutive edges are split. But in addition, if only one side is split, the term evaluates to 0.5, which also forces the t-variable to 1. But this is not all. Remember that we add this constraint for every half edge with permuted s variables. Another one of these permutations will evaluate to 0.5, while the other two evaluate to minus 0.5. This means instead of 1, 2 T variables are constrained to 1 for a single split side. The same happens if 3 sides are split. This behavior is pretty handy, as this means that splitting 1 or 3 sides is penalized twice as much as the insertion of a Y configuration, which makes sense as they introduce twice as many singularities. We compare our refinement formulation with the algorithm of John and colleagues. Again, we use as example setting the improvement of the surface approximation by splitting edges whose midpoint is too far away from the original surface. Since John and colleagues only split the magenta input edges, the result contains fewer elements than with our method. However, with our method, it is possible to invest a few more splits in order to achieve far fewer singularities and a more regular structure. Here's another example. Especially around the eye, one can see how our method inserts far fewer singularities, leading to a more regular structure. Before concluding this presentation, I would like to address the runtime of our algorithm. The main drawback of our method is its unpredictable runtime, needed by the numerical solver to find the optimal solution and verify its optimality. This limitation comes from the fact that solving a binary program is in general NP-hard. But still, the numerical solver that we used, Gurobi, was able to solve most problems in just a couple of seconds. However, with this cylinder, we found a problem that is particularly difficult. The set of mandatory split edges consists of the 19 edges of the boundary on the left side. 18 of those edges can be conformally split by inserting pairs of Y configurations. However, for the remaining edge, one of the edges on the right boundary has to be split. With a small singularity penalty, the numerical solver found the optimal solution in 1 second, but it took almost 10 minutes to prove optimality. Note, however, that using 3 refinement, the boundary with an odd number of elements can be split locally, and the solver is able to prove optimality in less than a second. In conclusion, we presented a quad mesh refinement algorithm based on a binary program formulation, whose solution is an anisotropic 2 refinement, which is optimal with respect to user preferences regarding singularities and mesh complexity. Our formulation provides detailed control over both number and location of singularities by employing user-defined singularity cost. We extended our method by providing a set of replacement templates for Y configurations, thus guaranteeing that every quad corner is split at most once, improving the minimal inner angles in the resulting mesh. Finally, a variation of our formulation solves a simpler problem at the cost of performing 3 refinement instead of 2 refinement. To our knowledge, this is the first algorithm allowing the trade-off between mesh complexity and number of singularities, as well as performing local anisotropic refinement of quad meshes. An interesting line of future investigation would be the development of a specialized solver that is able to solve the presented problems in a shorter and more predictable runtime, maybe at the cost of not finding the optimal solution, for applications where a good solution that is computed fast is more desirable than a provable optimal solution. Also interesting is the question of if quad mesh coarsening can be achieved with a similar formulation. Thank you very much for your attention.